Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the next concurrent session of the day, Keeping Online Students Engaged. Our presenter today is Dr. Jacqueline Jensen-Vallin from Lamar University. Jacqueline Jensen-Vallin is a professor of mathematics and director of the first year mathematics experience at Lamar University. In her role as director, she coordinates all first year and co-requisite math courses. This has included rewriting curricula for all first year courses, developing course-specific co-requisite courses, and continuing to monitor and adjust these six courses and their co-requisites. She is also the editor of NAA Focus. If you have any questions for the presenter during the session, please feel free to enter those into the Q&A box at the bottom of the Zoom room screen. Also, if you have any comments or things that you would like to share, since our chat is disabled, you can place those into the Q&A area as well, and we will address those at the end of the talk. On that note, I will hand it over to our presenter.
Thank you. Get my screen share working here. Okay. So thank you, and I appreciate Hawks organizing this event again. I find it really interesting and helpful every year. I've attended some really good sessions today, which make me want to rethink the things we're focusing on in my talk. So will there be a little bit of ad-libbing that happens? We've grown a lot in the past couple of years where we're not thinking about the online environment as merely a passing on of information, but also as a way that we can engage with students and better engage with students. And so I think that we've learned a lot, and some of this is stuff that was true, and some of this is stuff that we're trying, and some of this is stuff that we've kind of discarded. So there's just a whole bunch of ideas here. And I will be really happy and interested to hear what other people are doing and how it's working for them. I was at a talk before the plenary. We're especially interested in what to do with our online co-requisite courses, which are synchronous. Which are asynchronous, and therefore it's a little bit complicated to figure out how to engage them. So Lamar University is a regional state school. In many places, we would call ourselves a large school, but we're in Texas, so we're a middle-sized state school. We have about 14,000 students. Each year, we welcome about 2,400 first-year students. We have about 25% African-American students, about 22% Latinx students. We are currently working towards certification as a Hispanic serving institution. For years, we've had a lot of online courses. We have traditional distance ed. We have academic partnership students. We have students who are traditional face-to-face students who just take some online classes. As with lots of places, we've been developing online programs. And of course, COVID accelerated all of that. So in math, we offer all of the first year math courses and their co-requisites. This question came up earlier today. We do not do any co-req except for the one for contemporary mathematics in an 8-week format. Everything else is a 15-week format, but we do have college algebra with its co-req in 15 weeks fully online, intro stat with its co-req fully online 15 weeks. Pre-calculus is separate from college algebra for us, business math, which is reasonably new to us, and then the co-recs for all of those. We've had the calculus sequence online in 8-week format for many years, and we have linear algebra, differential equations, and a calc-based stat also online. So those upper level courses, like from calculus on up, are things that are pretty well established, and they've had some good reception, like they know what to do with those. I think when we start to move and reorganize the first year courses, especially with the co-req or the need for some coordination between the college side and the co-req side, is when we start to want to figure out more how to build community. We want the students to kind of be more interdependent than, this kind of interdependence that we can build in a face-to-face classroom. That's much harder, I think, to build online. So we have these weekly coordination meetings. And so this is literally something we talk about every week, is how to keep our students involved and active. This goes both for face-to-face and for online students. I have colleagues who swear by these weekly organizational announcements. They have it set to go out every Sunday. It gives a full week of everything that's due for, full list of everything that's due for the week. Here are the things that you have to cover. Here are your learning objectives. Here are the assignments that are due this week. Anything else I need you to know. And they do it all in one big announcement. I try not to do that with my courses because I feel like students don't always read the whole thing. Maybe that's me. I feel like students are more likely to take little chunks. And so I would rather personally, because those are all set up. I mean, theoretically, it's in the syllabus, it's in the weekly folders. They have access to that information somewhere else. And so I prefer to actually send out frequent announcements, an announcement every day or two, usually every couple of days, that gets sent straight to their email, but is also recorded. We use Blackboard in Blackboard for them to go back to. And they're short, like, what is most urgent right now? The one I had to send the other day was, hey, I'm realizing that some of you are not going back and looking at your graded work and not reading comments, and you keep making the same mistakes. And I keep taking off points for the same mistakes. Can we have, you know, can we have a conversation about how to fix that? Can I show you where to look for them? Like, what can I do for you? But I feel like one line or two lines or a short paragraph, my students are more likely to read. I know some programs on campus, our undergrad advising center, financial aid, they're all switching to text messaging the students, which I find really interesting, actually. It's not something I feel like I have the capability to do or necessarily the desire to do, but it is interesting that we're moving to shorter and shorter communication with the students, but more frequent touch points. I do try to remind them about due dates two or three times. I do try to remind them and use Hawks, because we use Hawks in many of these courses, from their email. Okay, I see you haven't gotten to your quiz yet. Don't forget it's due in 12 hours or whatever. I think it helps. I occasionally get students who reply going, yeah, I'm on it. I'll get to it after work. I don't know how much that helps them or how much they ignore them. I know that Blackboard for us sends out chunk emails. Here are all the things you that changed in any of your classes overnight. And there's so much information in there. I find that probably not a reliable way for me to connect with students. And so I do send the announcements out separately. But like I get a, you know, a batch email from Blackboard and it's like, here are the 400 things that were submitted. And here's all the announcements that were posted and all the classes you're responsible for. And I can't read that. I can't go through that very effectively. So I'm sure my students can't either. Especially if they have people loading a lot of content into Blackboard. This is actually one of my favorite things. And every semester, so we have coordinated courses, which means that the instructors agree to a set of course policies and agree about how we're going to implement the course. And every semester we have a conversation about whether or not we're going to use discussion boards. I love discussion boards. I almost always get overruled. I like discussion boards because in our learning management system, we can post the prompt and then they can not be allowed to see anybody else's response until after they've submitted theirs. And then we can ask them to respond to somebody else's or a couple of other people's and essentially grade for completion. It takes quite a while, I think, to learn how these prompts can be effectively graded. In other words, not turn into something where you have to address and comment on every student. Our online sections tend to run between 80 and 150 students, the ones that are designated online only courses. So if you're asking students to write a discussion post every week and comment on two other posts, you're reading 450 entries a week and it's just not feasible for class, right? Times four classes, you're at 1,800 entries to read per week. It's literally not feasible to do that. But I do think this is the best way that I have found to build asynchronous community, to really get them to read what other people are writing and comment on what other people are writing in some non-trivial way. They're not allowed to say, I agree. They're not allowed to say, yeah, what you said. They have to digest it, process it, and respond to it. I do find that when I do these discussion boards, as opposed to a journal entry, which is just literally like them recording information for themselves that I happen to get to read, when I do discussion boards, there's much more interaction among the students. They're much more likely to form study groups. They're much more likely to reach out, or at least maybe not substantially reach out, but they will say, I'm interested in a study group. Here's my cell number, which they post publicly. I don't know, but I'm interested in a study group. Reach out. Let me know how I can help you. I see you're struggling with this thing and I get it now. Let me help. And I love that. And I don't see that literally in any other way. Now, because of the grading weight here, it doesn't seem to happen very often. Like our instructors tend to prefer other ways of measuring engagement, but I don't think we get the same bang for our buck. So here's my like entry sample prompt. I try really hard in the entry prompt to point out that I want them to be a community. I want them to get to know each other, that I want them to work together, that I want them to engage with each other as well as with me. I get all kinds of things here. I get anything from I've always hated math to math is my favorite subject to I was always great in math, everybody should reach out to me to I have people connecting and sharing pictures of their dogs, which is great. They say, I also have a miniature schnauzer. Let me see the picture of yours. I'll show you a picture of mine. I also have twin boys. Hey, I also have a two-year-old. And they find each other and they realize they're not alone. And that is one of my favorite things about this assignment. Later in the semester, I want them kind of reflecting. Sometimes the prompts are metacognitive. Reflect on how you studied for the exam. Was that effective? What would you do differently? Sometimes it's about making connections. How is the content we're doing this week going to relate to your major, to your life, to whatever? What do you remember? What don't you understand yet? We try a bunch of those. I tried, I would not recommend this one. I'll just let you know. I tried one semester. Ask one question about something that you don't understand yet for exam two. And then for full credit, you have to go and answer somebody else's question. That was a mess. That was a hot mess because I had to make sure every question got answered. And I had to make sure when other people answered questions that they were correct and helpful, because some people can say something that's technically correct but doesn't actually address the question. And it was, and I think I only had like 40 or 50 students that semester. And that was just the worst grading experience I had all semester. It was exhausting. And trying to make sure everybody's question got addressed and trying to, I wouldn't recommend that one. But our instructors have come together and they have set up a pretty good set of questions like week by week for curriculum in at least two or three of our classes. And it's pretty exciting to see, and they'll share them. We have set up a Slack channel for the instructors and they'll share them in the Slack channel or private message each other, catch each other in the hall, like, hey, what are you doing this week? I did this and it was awful. It was so hard to grade. What did you do? And they write them down so they have them for the next semester. It's really cool. But discussion prompts are actually my favorite. We got really concerned that some students, especially in our co-rec, so in the college side, the students have weekly homework sets through whatever their homework system is. And so they're doing work there. In our co-rec, we call them all support courses. We have support for pre-cal, we have support for college algebra, foundations for college algebra. And in those foundations courses, we want them doing, when they're face-to-face, most of their work in class. But when they're online, you still want to make sure they're doing something. Like, are they watching the videos you're posting? Are they engaging the material in a meaningful way? Discussion prompts may or may not get at whether or not they're doing real math every week and whether they're learning the skills that will help them with their college side course. And so we've talked about this before, and when we were face-to-face, we actually did this a lot. And now that we're kind of reverting, we're back to this, where they're doing a lot more group work in class. Now for our asynchronous online, we have them doing weekly problem sets. These are supposed to be foundational problems. There's only three or five of them every week. They get posted in the learning management system. They have to respond in the LMS. We do not have our co-rec students in a separate, like Hawks course, for instance. And so we're not assigning homework that way. So this is like their weekly homework, but they're really short because they're supposed to be able to, in the face-to-face classes, hopefully they're having these addressed in their groups. They have to write them up and turn them in. Online, they have to do them and turn them in. So they're not supposed to take a ton of time. They're fine. They do not develop community. As I mentioned earlier, I had to send an announcement the other day for my co-rec students and say, I'm taking time to write you comments and questions and answers and give you explanations about your graded work. And you're not looking at them because you're still making very similar mistakes. What's up? We do try to get them to use math type in Blackboard, or they can scan it or take a photo and upload that. This does build mathematical responsibility. It does help build the content, but it definitely does not build community. There's nothing here that gets them to be more likely to engage with me, unfortunately, or definitely not more likely to engage with each other, especially for the students who are fully online. There's no reason for them to reach out to each other. It does make them log in. It does make them look at the LMS every week, but I don't think it really helps them communicate with each other or, like I said, communicate with me. So what else could we try? I think Facebook is too outdated. I really feel like Twitter is way too public. Somebody's going to see one of my students post a question, and then all of a sudden it's going to blow up into this crazy thing when all they wanted to know was how to factor a quadratic. We've done group me's with some success, some failure. I had one semester where the group me was fantastic. I posted the link and all, and I required approval to join, so we didn't get people who shouldn't be in the class kind of in there and making comments. They asked each other questions. They said, hey, how do you do this problem? And they would post a picture, or hey, this is my work for such and such. But Hawks didn't like my answer, and somebody will pipe in and say, oh, Hawks wants a point, not an X equals, or vice versa. It can work really well in terms of them connecting with each other. And I found that if I didn't hop in right away, they were way more likely to form their community, which is not a surprise. So the students, sorry, I got distracted for a second. Wait for them to have a chat with each other, moderate when I have to, tell them they can ask each other questions during an exam. It works pretty well. Some semesters, the group me never takes off. They decide that they don't want to talk to each other. Some semesters, almost nobody joins. Some semesters, the only thing they post is what's the deadline or what's next. I don't know how to predict it. I don't know which groups are going to be good group me groups and which groups are going to be not forming community. I also, in terms of keeping communication open, in terms of keeping access to me open and having students do know what's expected of them and doing what they're supposed to be doing, I use a lot of the Hawks tools. The search by criteria is fantastic. Somebody mentioned earlier that they gotten a lot of success from their co-rec students by giving them like attaboy and attagirl. So instead of just searching for the students who are not finishing their work or not being successful, they search for the students who are doing everything they're supposed to. The ones who are doing literally all their stuff, and they send good job messages to them. And I think that's really helpful, and they get students who respond really positively to that. So when they get some praise, they work harder, which is cool. Same thing for web test by test. And the other thing I use web test by test for is my own accountability, which is, and I just had this conversation with an instructor a week or two ago, was to look at the test they had written. And, you know, they weren't happy with the success rate of their students. And I was like, well, which problems did they miss? And this was a face-to-face section, so it's a little bit different. What did your students miss? Is it something that maybe you could have said more clearly? Is it something, you know, for an online class, is it something that you forgot to post a video about, you didn't realize was in the curriculum? Is it something that you had six students email you about and you never managed to get a coherent response back to everybody? What happened? Was that just you picked the hardest one out of that section and it was way too hard? Like what happened? So I use that kind of to make sure that I'm not doing anything that's not ensuring the success of my students. So I wrote this significantly like a few weeks ago. I actually wrote a version of this that we talked about a year ago. And I was really convinced that in synchronous online courses that you would have to post fewer, I'm feeling super silly about this, that you would have to post fewer announcements and fewer accountability and fewer, because they were supposed to all log in with you and you could post the recordings of that. And since you were posting the recordings and at the beginning of each thing, you talked through what was due that week or what was next or what the expectations were. I was like, I'm not going to need to write 500 announcements. I'm not going to have to monitor discussion boards because they're all going to be in a room, virtual room together. And therefore they're going to meet each other. And I am really embarrassed to say that that is not how that went. For those of you who've done synchronous online, you're sitting there going like, yeah, it didn't go that way for me either. As we all know, nobody has their camera on. There were several students, like the best teaching day I had in the fall with a synchronous online course was like everybody started giving each other grief in the chat and it was hysterical. So we were, I don't remember what we were working on, but they would pop into the chat with the answer. I was like, okay, so we have to solve this quadratic. So does it factor? And they're like, yes, it factors. And somebody else is typing the factorization and somebody else is doing whatever. And they're like, man, so-and-so is super fast. Like, and they just started like messing with each other. My challenge for today is get one answer in before Mariah. No, I'm going to beat Dante. You know, it was hysterical. It was so funny because I really was super, super convinced like this is going to be great. But that was the only form of community that happened. And it seemed to only happen among those top students or the students who are willing to drop stuff in chat. Everybody else kind of sat there with their camera off and either didn't log in or watched the video or, you know, watched the video. and there was not this community that I had like hoped and dreamed about. I was like, it's going to be great because we're all there together. It wasn't like that. So I'm still really fundamentally attached to discussion boards. My instructors just keep vetoing me. Asynchronous, I really think that you need to find these other ways, right, to get them to engage with you, but also to get them to engage with each other. Especially, I think, for those co-rec students, we're asking so much of those co-rec students. We're asking them to do. So in Texas right now, we're 100% co-rec. So we used to have a standalone, like basic algebra class that students would take before they co-rec into one of our algebraic tracks. And as of last fall, as of fall of 21, that's gone. So we are getting literally any student who's admitted to Lamar has to co-rec. And for the students who are non-algebraic, those co-recs are 1 to 2 extra hours. But for the algebraic students, those co-recs are 2 or 3 hours. And for our pre-calculus students who are on the STEM track, we are asking an awful lot of those students. They're heavily calculator dependent. We're asking them to do lots of things without calculators. they're lacking some significant algebra skills, and we're trying to get them to do that plus the pre-calculus content and functions. And it's just a lot. And so if they don't have each other, if we can't find these ways for them to support each other, it's going to be very, very hard for them. So I'm about to maybe put my foot down about discussion boards, even though the instructors hate grading them. I can't think of anything better, another way for the asynchronous people to manage to interact with each other. So concerns and experiences, things that haven't worked very well or have been problematic or concerning include, of course, childcare issues, especially for our asynchronous students, the distractions of being home, the distractions of having a job, COVID, internet access. For those synchronous students, it made me so sad last fall when I realized how hard it was for our students who were at school on our campus to log in reliably to a synchronous meeting from their dorm rooms. It was embarrassing. It made me super sad. Like, we had students who would sit in their car outside the library because it was better reception than they had in their dorm room when they needed to stream. It was such a mess. We have a lot of returning students. We have a lot of students who are military, sometimes overseas. We have a lot of students who work out on the oil rigs in the Gulf of Mexico, which is pretty interesting. So they'll actually try to do their work in patches, which makes it a little bit hard for kind of a traditional time release kind of class where you're like, okay, this week we're doing this and next week we're doing this, synchronous or asynchronous. And so they try to get ahead. They'll try to do 3 or 4 weeks worth of work in a week because they know that they're going to not have Wi-Fi for 2 weeks. And it's pretty interesting. It also creates issues with building community. Although I think in general, the students I've had who fall into that category are way more likely to reach out to their classmates than some of our traditional students. Internet connection issues, even on campus. I had a student the year we shut down for COVID. I had a student that year, she had moved home and she logged in for a synchronous meeting. We were just gonna work some stat problems, quote unquote, just. And her family didn't understand when she was in class. And so they would like walk into the living room and turn on the TV really loud. She couldn't be in her bedroom because the Wi-Fi didn't reach. She couldn't be in the dining room because it was next to the living room and the TV was on. So one day she decided to log into class from the front porch. When we're on the call, one of her family members walked out of the house, closed the door. She's like, hey. And they were like, okay, well, I'm going out for a while. She's like, okay, see you in a bit. They locked her out. She sat on the front porch until they got home. I was like, oh my gosh. So we chatted for a while, kept her company for a little bit. It was like just those kinds of things are not predictable. Anyway, distractions of being home. I think most of us are pretty familiar with at this point. I think 2 years ago it was a little surprising and now we're all like, yeah, that's all happened. So how do we do this with really large sections? Like I said, our asynchronous online sections in particular are usually at least 65, 80, sometimes 120. My favorite way to build community online and have them interact with me is this discussion boards, but I can't do that with a large group. I mean, not if you're teaching more than one section, it's just not possible. I think that the group me also caused me some trouble because I had a lot of issues. You know, I installed it on my phone and every time my phone lit up, I felt like I had to respond to my students and they would work hours where I didn't want to work. So my phone would light up at 10 or 11 o'clock at night. And if it was a question about something that was due that night or due the next day, I felt like I had to respond right away. And so I had a lot of trouble for a while, kind of separating those things. I got better at it, but it was really hard. And then my current torture, concern, question is how do I manage to have them build community? So I want these like non-threatening prompts for a discussion board in some way so that they're comfortable talking about it and sharing and commenting on other people's, with my desire to make sure that those engagements are also mathematically meaningful. And I'm struggling with this, like I want to use these weekly problem sets. So I see them do in the co-rec, I see them do some math every week, but I also want them to also have an opportunity to engage with each other and form this community and the support group. And so, I mean, just in terms of grades, how do I do that? What's the right percentage to give to these different things in terms of, because we know students are going to prioritize something they're getting credit for, and that's fair. They only have so much time. So how do I prioritize these things in terms of their course grade? The co-recs are pass fail, but I still don't want to give them necessarily 70% of their course grade for doing non-mathematical things. I want some of that to be mathematical engagement as well. In every co-rec except for the one for pre-calculus, that one's just a different creature because sometimes we have a lot to do in there. For all the other ones, they have separate journal prompts, not to be confused with discussion boards, which is problematic, that they do four times a semester, which are definitely metacognitive and focused on being either exam preview or exam wrapper kinds of things. So we're kind of building some of the metacognition into those other assignments. Those are journals. They're submitted only for instructors to read. So they're supposed to be able to be kind of honest about where they're struggling, which is harder to do publicly, and be able to ask questions there and be able to confess, I guess. For the exam wrappers, like, how did the exam go? How did you feel about that? What are you going to do differently next time? And some of that they'll be happy to say kind of publicly, but I don't want a student saying that they got a 20 on the exam because whatever, like, they don't necessarily want or need to admit that publicly. So anyway, these are the things that we continue to think about, is how to make better and better online experiences for our students, for a lot of our students, actually. Like I said, these courses are really big. And in particular, like several people, I was in a couple of talks this morning and they've all brought this up. What about these co-rec students? Like, how do we make this a meaningful experience for them when it's online and asynchronous? How do we make sure they're getting what they need? How can I, in a classroom, I can adjust based on which questions I'm getting or based on conversation I hear before class, and I can't do that asynchronously. And so I want to tell me, right? How do I make those experiences really meaningful for them, as opposed to kind of just like throwing some stuff out there and kind of hoping that I've hit the right mark. Here are some things I think you'll need this week. Boom. And then sitting there and like, you know, either getting no feedback from the students or finding out later that it was the wrong stuff. We have started, there are several sessions also about accountability and student honesty in an online format. And I've heard some people mention like photomath and other things in sessions today. And so we decided, when all of these courses rotated online and all of our assessments rotated online, that everything was going to be open notes. And so one of the comments we get most often on exam wrappers is, my notes were not organized. I thought I had good notes. I couldn't find anything in there. And so then we can start intervening and saying, okay, well, since you couldn't find anything in there, here are some tricks to get your notes more organized. And I love when I can do those as discussion boards, because they always help each other. They're like, I color code, so all my definitions are in blue, or I use stickies for the beginning of each section. I had several students one semester who were like, I realized I needed to cross out or throw out the pages where the solutions were wrong, because those were the ones I followed when I took the exam. And I was like, oh, that hurts. You know, just they didn't realize that if they didn't cross it out, they might think it was a real thing. And so those are the models they used when they were solving other problems. I love exam wrappers too. I love anything that's metacognitive for our first year students. I think they don't know how to study. They don't know how to take notes. They don't know how to engage with material. And so any way that we can encourage them to think about what does or doesn't work for them, I think is really helpful. Anyway, I have lots of ideas and things that are working and things that aren't working. And we change policies and plans and attempts every semester. We're trying for continuous improvement was our phrase as a department a couple of years ago. But I would love to hear what other people are doing. And I would love to answer any questions you have about things that we've tried that work or haven't worked.
Thank you so much. It does look like we have some comments and questions coming in already. Everyone, if you have a question or comment you'd like to share, go ahead and throw it in the chat box. I'm sorry, not the chat box. I said that I'll have it, the Q&A box there at the bottom of your Zoom room screen. We had some comments of just thinking, you know, thank you for sharing things that have worked and haven't worked. It's always great to learn from one another. Mary Jackson says you may look into pack back rather than a traditional discussion board. Have you heard of that?
I have not heard of that. I will have to look that up. That's very helpful. I love anything that makes life a little bit easier is great.
Yes, absolutely. Ooh.
I love anything that does the grading for me. I just saw that pop in. Sorry. Yes. Not in a bad way, because I want to read their responses, but you get overwhelmed and you want to say, like, you gave a great initial post and you responded to some people and I don't care what you said to them, more or less. Like, I mean, I care very much, but you know what I mean.
Yes. And Gaitri, I'm sorry, I'm trying to pronounce your name, ask, could you please discuss the journaling? Do you do it 4 times per term, more or less?
So we usually do journals, like formal journals, 4 times per term. They're generally shared across all co-recs, because the same thing's appropriate for all of the students in any of those co-rec courses. The first one is a short video of somebody talking about how they study for mathematics. I can find that if you email me, I can easily find it and email it to you. He essentially says, I start studying early. I study all the time, so I'm studying, not cramming. I take a break right before and I make sure my notes are organized or something like that. Like, there's 4 or 5 really good tips. And the journal prompt is, watch the video, pick any 2 tips that you think you can implement. We do it the week before the exam, so they have time to kind of think about how they're going to implement. Pick 2 things you're going to implement and write a paragraph about each of them. And a paragraph can be 3 sentences. It doesn't have to be very much. We do ask them to write about 1/2 page and 12 points. The second one is always, how did the first exam go? Which of those tips did you employ? Were they successful? Were they not? What are you going to do differently next time? The third one is right before exam 2. It's always, look back at your exam wrapper after exam 1. What did you tell yourself? What are you doing this week? Like, you gave yourself some advice. What did past you tell present you? Go do it. And then the last one is a course wrapper. Is a, okay, we're at the end. What worked for the co-rec? What didn't work for the co-rec? What could we change for future versions of the co-rec? What was most helpful? What was least helpful? That kind of thing.
That's awesome. Thank you for sharing that detail. It definitely sounds like wonderful reflection opportunities for them. We have a few more comments and questions coming in. Beth Jones shares, we use peer reviews of written work as well as the Inscribe community discussion board for students to post questions to create community in our online courses. We also have large coordinated courses, and all students in all of the online sections of a particular course are in the same Inscribe community.
Nice.
Thank you for sharing that.
I don't know that one either, so that's always fun. Yes. I'm like, oh, look that up. And the other thing that I really love about this conference is that it is interdisciplinary. And so frequently people from non-math disciplines have access to and think about tools I didn't know were out there because they're very well used in your discipline. And I'm like, ooh, let's see how I can translate that. And I write them down.
Absolutely. Wonderful opportunities to look new things up, try new things. Dr. Sora says, group wikis, yes or no? I use them in psychology. We do two of them. After the first, we shuffle the groups for the second. And I use a project wrapper too.
I have never done that. One of the constraints, and so I don't know that much about group wikis. One of the things that we're trying really hard to do, we're kind of encouraged to do by our university, is have everything linked to the one Blackboard course. So is that something that could link to the Blackboard shell? Because if I have to have them go to too many different places, they're not going to find it. So, you know, when we use Hawks, they can click the button and it takes them straight into Hawks. Wikis are in Blackboard too. Okay, cool.
Awesome.
Good. We haven't tried those. I will have to look. And I love anything that like helps them interact with each other, right? Especially when I can't have them in a room and make them do it.
Absolutely. Katri says that she'll probably connect with you outside of the meeting today, and she has more questions. So, and thanks you for sharing your activities. Thank you, everybody. This has been a wonderful discussion. If anyone else has anything they'd like to share, comment, questions, please continue to insert those into the Q&A box. I have a quick question, if I may interject. I was wondering, you mentioned Facebook being outdated as far as assembling groups. Is that something that you had tried in the past? It just felt like, okay, this isn't working anymore.
So I tried it a while ago. Let's just go with a while ago.
Okay.
Where I had a private group for one of the classes. Thank you. I had a private group for one of the classes, and what my students did was they would like take pictures of the board during class and post the pictures. So everybody always had a full set of notes from the class. I mean, it was very effective in that way. Mm-hmm. As kind of a repository of information. I had some students who at the time didn't want to engage with that kind of social media in particular. Future teachers don't want some sort of social media presence necessarily. And I think that's actually super smart. So that was like, I felt weird asking people to make a Facebook account. But I also think that today's college students aren't on Facebook. And if I ask them to get on Facebook, they're going to be like, why? I think Snapchat would be really effective, but I'm not getting on Snapchat. So I think we're at, like, I'm at that point where what I am comfortable with for social media is not where my students are. You know, I could make TikToks showing them how to solve a problem. That'd probably be really effective, but I'm probably not going to do that.
That's great. Do we have anyone making TikToks? Mary says she's used YouTube for online speeches, but there are problems with that too. Mary, do you mind sharing what problems you've encountered, if you feel comfortable sharing that in the Q&A? Just curious. We have some comments. Just thank you for your valuable information. I'll ask another question. Was it similar problems that you encountered with the GroupMe? Because I know you said it was met with both success and failure whenever you tried the GroupMe method.
I wish I could figure it out, kind of. I think it was just the group of students somehow. And I don't know, like maybe if I tried it again, it would be fine. And then we had a weird situation with one of the GroupMes where some student somewhat clearly intended to post to a separate group me, which was a private message to a student, but he posted in the whole group me, and he was asking for help on an exam problem, so he caught cheating, and that kind of stopped all conversation in there.
Yeah. You know,
so I think they at that point, I think everybody else backed off the group me. And it was like, that's not really what I wanted to have happen. Yeah, I wish I could. It's kind of like some even in face-to-face classes, some semesters you have a group who's willing to just share everything and they're out there and they're engaged. And some semesters you can be teaching the same class in the same time slot and the students are still not interested in interacting with each other at all. And I think that's just what happened with the group me, is that some semesters it's great and some semesters people are like, nah.
Yeah. Sounds like the key is flexibility.
I think we're rotating a lot lately.
Thank you. And for answering those questions, and we do have a few more comments coming in. Mary did go ahead and share a little bit more about her experience with YouTube. The videos can be set to private, but then she can't open them either. Most students know how to do it, but then some are hesitant to go to YouTube. So she also doesn't like to ask students to create on YouTube because it feels like she's exposing them to a possible channel for identity issues. And she worries about that with FERPA rules. But Dr. Sarr says groups tab in Blackboard has the ability to do a lot of group engagement. Thank y'all for sharing those comments. It does look like that our discussion has brought us to the end of our time, and it's always so wonderful to have engaging Q&A sessions like this. So thank you all for your questions and comments and sharing your experience. And of course, thank you to our presenter for a wonderful session. Very informative, very engaging. And thank you for sharing what has worked, what hasn't worked, and what you're going to try next. That was all very helpful.
Thank you. I appreciate you being here.
And everyone, I just want to say thank you so much for your time today. I hope you're enjoying the conference so far. We are nearing the end. So at this time, I do want to go ahead and paste the links for our next sessions into the chat. I'm going to go ahead and do that right now. So our next concurrent session will begin at 3:00 p.m. Eastern. You can view the chat for your session meeting room links, or of course, access our conference website for a complete list of our sessions and their descriptions. As you may have seen in the chat earlier, we did have a little bit of a mix-up on our conference website with Dr. Jensen-Vallin's session synopsis or summary. So I'm so sorry about that. Our marketing team is adjusting that now. And we apologize for any confusion. And just so you know, we will have recordings of all sessions. I know it's hard to pick and choose which ones to go into, but we will have recordings for these sessions so that you can enjoy them later as well and share with your colleagues. By the way, if you have not yet gone to our conference website, make sure you do, and don't forget to swing by our virtual exhibit hall to say hello to the rest of our Hawks team. If you stick around for just a quick 5-minute demonstration at the virtual booth, you'll be entered to win one of our hourly giveaways, which includes prizes such as your choice of a 6-month subscription to Audible, 1-year subscription to Disney Plus, or $100 Amazon gift card. We will see you all at our next session. Bye, everybody.